I feel like going to a good gig and going to a good show at a gallery isn't really that different. You know, I'm looking to be moved, and that can happen in a room full of a couple thousand people with a band playing, and that can happen when I'm standing in front of a painting.
That's California-based artist Justine Frischmann. This month, she's got a new solo show of her abstract paintings opening at Unspeakable Projects in San Francisco. The show is called The Battle of Faith and Doubt. Recently, I spoke with Justine over the phone about her upcoming exhibition, her painting process, and making the transition from successful rock musician to abstract painter. Justine Frischmann is coming up on Art Uncovered. Stay tuned.
I'm Justine Frischmann, and I'm a painter.
Well, Justine, thanks so much for coming on the show.
Yeah, thank you for asking me.
Yeah, I kind of wanted to start with this new show you have coming up. It's your first solo show, is that right?
It is, yeah.
Cool. And so it's called The Battle of Faith and Doubt. And is that title, is that sort of a reference to your artistic process?
Yeah, it's referencing my my creative life, but it's also referencing my life. I mean, I feel like to be an artist is to have tremendous faith, to sort of step out into the unknown, and just to be a human being, I think, takes tremendous faith, just getting out of bed in the morning.
How does that play out in the actual act of making the paintings? How does that manifest itself?
I work quite quickly on each piece, but you know, I tend to make a lot of revisions and to wipe things out and move quickly while the painting's wet. So, you know, I feel like there's a sort of restlessness in my work. I feel like I'm quite good at not overworking things. But paintings often get to a state where they're just pretty good. They're pretty good, but they're not special. And, you know, so there's a big part of the faith component is just being prepared to completely ruin something in order to have something surprising happen or sort of transcendent. You know, I'm always searching for that moment when you look at a painting and it's sort of nothing to do with you, like something's moved through you accidentally. And, you know, it often happens when I'm just in the middle of getting rid of something. And I'll just, you know, in that split second realize that something's happening that is special.
So how did you arrive at abstract painting? Is that something you just sort of were always interested in? Or did you go through like a phase where you were painting landscapes or something and then realized,
you know,
this is not for me? Or,
you know, when I was growing up, I loved drawing people, so I did tons and tons of portraits, and the first painters that I fell in love with were portrait painters, and you know, then music took over for years and years, and I didn't really make any visual work. And when I came back to it 7 or 8 years ago, I found that I just, the most interesting thing for me was to be making abstract work. It just felt more exciting and more uncertain and more magical in a way.
You have a series of paintings on your website called Demiurge. A lot of those pieces are done with spray paint and other materials, but you sort of have kind of a visual theme running through them, which are these sort of series of lines. They're sort of like, if, you know, if someone like were to draw a route on a map and then you erase the map. I was hoping that you could talk a little bit just sort of about where these paintings come from and kind of your interest in that line form that sort of appeared over and over and over again.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, on my website, I've got the Demiurge and I've got Lambent, and, you know, but in a way it's, you know, I'll get an idea and I'll riff on it and I'll just keep riffing on it until I can't find anything else or it's actually morphed into something else. The Demiurge series, you know, I feel like it does reference maps, and it references architecture. I studied architecture. I've got a degree in architecture. It's the first thing that I went to school to do. And the idea of demiurge is it's man's desire to make nature rectilinear, so to impose a kind of logic on top of something that's not logical, just so that we can navigate it. And, you know, in making those paintings, again, it's a sort of exercise in meditation or staying in the zone. You have paint on your brush, and the brush starts in one corner. And over, you know, a short period of time, you're going to get from one place to another, just following the impulses to turn when you need to. I mean, it's almost like a dance. And, you know, if your concentration breaks, or if, you know, doubt overtakes you, then you'll see it in the line. So it's almost a way of measuring that process somehow.
You have one that has a great title called Pink Grid Destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
That's sort of kind of the breakdown of that mm-hmm. Rigidity that you were sort of talking about.
Well, with Pink Grid Destroyed, that was, I think, the first moment that I realized that I could actually wipe the oil paint, and I think it happened by accident, and I realized that there's something new happened when it got destroyed in that way. And you know, that's one of the reasons I love using panel, because you can actually wipe stuff out without it leaving any trace. So it allows for those kind of possibilities.
I mean, I mentioned the title Pink Grid Destroyed, mm-hmm. and I'm always curious, especially for people who make abstract work, what their thoughts are on titling things.
Mm.
Do you have a methodology or just thoughts generally about titling your artwork?
You know, sometimes things just come to me, and, you know, I've been organizing my work into series, as I described. So sometimes I'll just number them according to what series they seem to fit into. And that's the sort of simplest way to do it. You know, I'm always listening to music while I'm working. So sometimes a particular song or a particular phrase from a song will get stuck, and somehow the energy will work its way into what I'm doing, and then I'll name the painting after that song.
Can you give us an example of a song that found its way into a painting?
Yeah, I've got Another Green World as one of my paintings. Free Range mm-hmm. ended up in a painting. I've got a painting called Magic Bus. It doesn't look like a bus.
That's cool. And do you have things that you commonly listen to while you paint? I mean, I guess Brian Eno kind of makes sense, given
yeah.
the work that you do. But
Brian Eno is the main thing I listen to. You know that Music for Airports, that uh-huh. first track, Music for Airports,
yeah.
Just really puts me in the zone. You know, I listened to that in so many different kinds of altered states for years that I feel like I can sort of automatically access more kind of hallucinogenic parts of my brain when I'm listening to that. So I quite often have that on repeat.
You said you started painting about 8 years ago, is that right?
Mm-hmm, that's right.
Yeah. And so you said before that you were pretty into music, and you actually had, for people who don't know, you had a pretty successful career as a musician. You played and sang in a band called Elastica, which I fondly remember listening to when I was a kid and enjoying. So that's very cool. But I'm curious for you, what the experience was like going from being really successful in one creative field mm-hmm. to starting, you know, in at the ground floor in mm-hmm. a completely different creative field. What was that experience like?
It was actually a fantastic experience. There's some part of me that's very restless in that way and easily bored. And I think, you know, I really enjoyed making music in the early days, just before it got big. And then as soon as it got big, it became sort of flabby and less interesting. And more about kind of dealing with, you know, press and media and and less about making music. And I think, you know, so for me, it's a total joy to be back at ground level, just pottering away and tinkering. You know, that's what I love to do. I think there's a certain level of success that you need in any field to just carry on working. You know, at some point I realized that I needed a community and I needed deadlines, and somewhere to put my paintings. Or otherwise, you know, I would lack the impetus to make them. You know, I'm someone who really needs deadlines. And that drove me to actually kind of set foot outside of the garage and actually try and find places where I could show work and try and find other painters to connect with. Mm-hmm. But I think there's a real joy in just quietly doing your own thing. Mm.